Welcome, find a seat. So again, this is Mafia Sessions with Group Y, the very first one. So you guys are part of the inaugural event. It's very exciting. And we are here today basically, you know, paying a tribute to the female pioneers in snowboarding. So this is a very exciting group of women that we have here. I don't know if you guys did a little bit of research and saw the materials, but let's do a quick overview of who we have here. At the end, we have Miki Keller. She, back in the day, was doing marketing at Morrow Snowboards, which was a big brand. And she also founded the WMA, which is the Women's Motocross Pro Championship. So Miki's done a lot of amazing things for women's action sports, but specifically in moto, I think. That's exciting. And then we have Kathleen Gasperini, who is one of the co-founders of Boarding for Breast Cancer. And she was also the first editor of Snowboarder magazine. And currently, she's the SVP of Label Networks. Yeah. So yeah, give it up. And next to Kathleen, we have Lisa Hudson, who's also one of the co-founders of Boarding for Breast Cancer. And she did marketing at Airwalk back in the day, and currently she's the owner and president of Black Sun Productions. So that's Lisa. And then we have Gaylene Nagel, who was doing marketing at Sims, another huge snowboard company back in the day, and is currently, I'm drawing a blank, sorry. That's right, M3 Mobile Marketing. So she works on apps, and it's a lot of action sports in the digital realm. So that's Gaylene. And then also to add to that, EA Sports, when they first started doing skate and snowboard video games. So I played SSX. It was really fun. And then we have Shannon Dunn-Downing, who is a former professional snowboarder and a two-time Olympian. Also was, I guess, technically kind of one of the first women to have a pro model snowboard. And she helped create the Burton Feel Good series. So I think maybe a lot of you guys remember that, you know, in the Burton line. And currently she's down in Southern California and an amazing mom, which is just as hard as being a professional snowboarder. And then we have Cara-Beth Burnside, and CB, that's her nickname, is also a former professional snowboarder and currently professional skateboarder. She was also an Olympian, and she's the only person, aside from Sean White, that has a medal in both winter and summer X Games. And she also co-founded the Alliance, Action Sports Alliance, as well as Hoopla Skateboards, which is an all-girls skate deck company. So pretty amazing up here, all-star lineup. So yeah, it's really casual. We're just gonna, you know, I've talked to these women individually, and I just wanted to share with you guys some of their stories and their insights. It's really inspirational, I think, for a lot of the girls here who do work in the industry to learn from people who paved the way. And yeah, so I'm going to, I guess, kind of target the questions a little bit, but why don't we start off with Lisa, so we can pass the mic to her. Lisa, if you want to just tell us a little bit about what it was like back then when you guys were kind of getting into it was like this brand new thing, you didn't even know what it was, snowboarding in general, you know, how you kind of fell into the industry and, like, what it felt like. Did you know it was going to be this thing, or was it kind of just, you know, just talk a little bit about that.
Well, I first started off in action sports, it was the 80s, so I was in the volleyball side. And I played pro beach volleyball for many years and ran the Women's Pro Volleyball Association in 1989, I started in marketing at Airwalk, and they had not yet launched their snowboard boots. So I kind of pioneered the whole snowboard team and recruited all the athletes to come and ride for us. Back in the day, the boots were so bad. they were big, they were bulky. Most of the riders would downsize from like a size 10 to a size 7 and put like a Dale boot liner in there. We didn't have any budget for it. I didn't really pay the athletes anything, but they could always come into Airwalk and carry out as many shoes as they could. That was my payment for them. So they'd come in and carry out like 12 pairs of boots and shoes, and that was their payment for it. But it was a really exciting time. There weren't many women out there at all. I made a point of adding women to the snowboard team. At that point, Tina Basich was my first female pro rider, and it was a young, new sport. And we were talking last night about surfing and skateboarding and how challenging it is for women to get involved in those sports. And with snowboarding, it was all so new back then that if you snowboarded, you were immediately part of this community and this club. And, you know, it was us against the skiers trying to fight for an ability to ride on a mountain, let alone you couldn't have a park or a half pipe or anything like that. But we were all fine just going and building a kicker or sessioning a rail or whatever we could find to do. So women, I think it was easier for us to get involved and get accepted. And the big push for us was to really move into women's specific equipment. And after doing Airwalk, I went to Swag, started a snowboard brand called Swag, and started Prom, which was the first women's snowboard clothing. And Shannon and Tina started that line with me. And I remember seeing, it was back in the days of the fat pants, big stance. So a size large was like a 38 size waist. And everything was so big and baggy. And I think we ran an ad with Shannon where she was doing like a tail grab, but the air had come up into her outfit and she looked huge. And the girls would always like, you know, sew it and cut it and cut it down. And at that point, we just said, you know, we've got to start making women's specific clothing. There was a lot of women riders, and we just decided that it was time. So we made a really girly line called Prom, and Tina and Shannon did all the design, and we had pinks and pastels, and you know, it was really exciting to see that it was something we fought hard for, but the industry and the retailers really responded to. And at that point, it was like, okay, like women are here to stay. They're not going anywhere. More and more girls were getting into it, and equipment was being specifically made for it. But it was young, and it was exciting, and it was new, and we were just kind of breaking down boundaries and barriers and fighting against the skiers, and it was, you know, it was a lot of fun.
Awesome. Love it. All right, well, we're going to pass over the microphone to Kathleen. And so, Kathleen, coming on the editorial side of things, you know, you had mentioned that you started off your career writing and, you know, doing a lot of journalism. Why do you think it's valuable for women to have sort of their voice in this sport or these sports? Like, why, you know, why is it important?
I think it's critical to the sports to grow, to have women writers and women interviewed and have women involved in all sorts of editorial, from video to magazines. I mean, when I started, I was hired for Powder Magazine, and at the time, the interview process was to go to Mammoth and ski with the editors to make sure I could keep up on double blacks, and it was a really difficult thing because there were no women in the editorial side of those types of magazines. And at the time frame, it was, you know, late 80s, beginning of the 90s, and we're like, wait a second, maybe we should start a magazine called Snowboarder. And I thought, well, you know, does that mean I can write features versus these little crappy stories in Powder? And they're like, well, if you learn to ride, maybe we can, you know, figure it out. And what was really interesting with what we started in the editorial side, too, is I would write about some snowboarders sometimes in Powder Magazine, you know, because there was no place for it. And then when we started Snowboarder, it was amazing how many women kind of came out of the woodwork or would come up and say, you know what, I read that article. I'm from Minnesota, and I really, all I have is a park, but I'm out there. I'm gonna learn how to ride. You know, I've got Sorels. I've got duct tape. I'm good, you know. And it was really amazing to see, you know, to give women voice. And there's a sense of responsibility too, that you feel like, oh God, you know, they really want that story. They're reading that story over and over and over again. So the challenge at the time was to convince some of the editors that, you know, we have to get more women writers out there, and we have to also get more women photographers to shoot the sport, and videographers and so on. But it's really vital for, you know, what you're doing with Mahfia Sessions is absolutely wonderful. And today it's a lot, it's great. I think things have come a long way because you can blog, you know, you have social media tools, you can do a lot of social networking, and you can have an Instagram following, and you can show your love of, you know, the sport. And that's a great thing for young women coming into the realm.
Awesome, thanks. We're actually gonna go pass this back this way. Want to talk to the athletes here. Obviously, you know, without the riders, there would be no industry. And I just want to ask both Shannon and CB, what was it like back then? Literally being the first, you know, snowboarders, period. Like, it's pretty mind-blowing to think, okay, you know, the other sports, basketball, soccer, tennis, like, you probably weren't the first, you know, but what did it, you know, how, what was your guys' perspective? Was it, like, serious, or were you just having fun, or tell us about just that time period, I guess, and your mentality when you started out?
Well, when I started out, Shannon had, you know, there was already a group of girls in the sport, and I was skateboarding, and there was just so hard to skateboard and try to be a professional girl skater when you're the only one out there. And I skate against the guys, and I wanted to travel and be a pro skater. And I tried and tried, and then I found snowboarding, and I go see the contest, and I saw Shannon and Tina and Michelle, and I, you know, so they were doing this, and it was like, wow, that's what I want to do with skating, but I'm going to learn how to do that because it's so similar. And they were, you know, it was already, I think like Lisa said, or it was just like a community, and girls were accepted where skateboarding it wasn't. And so it just seemed so natural for me to get good at snowboarding. I loved it. And I thought it was going to be easy to just get on there and go, but it was actually hard to learn. But it was cool. I would go to a couple contests and see you guys ride, you know, before I even knew you. And it was, that inspired me to do that because I wanted to travel. And so.
Although I have to add that, so we were out riding today, and CB, I've known CB through skateboarding for a while now, and she's been like, I want to go get back on the snow. And I was like, hey, we got to go. And so it was the first time riding with her, and you haven't been on a snowboard in 5+ years?
Yeah.
So got new gear, drops into the super pipe, and man, you guys have seen it, and it's just boosting, and I'm like, how is that even possible? It was insane. It was pretty awesome, like, first run. But so yeah, it's definitely amazing to watch. So Shannon, I guess, talk about, like, what was it like in the early days with the contest? And, you know, it started out pretty just kind of organic, and it seemed like it was really fun, and you guys were just all kind of like building kickers or shoveling these pipes and stuff, and then the evolution to, you know, basically hear that it was going to be in the Olympics. Like, what was that process like for you?
So I started snowboarding in 1988, I think, around then, and you know, like Lisa was saying, there were hardly any women. I think it was me, my friend, and I, and then I would do a few contests locally in Colorado. I grew up in Steamboat Springs, and there were only like a handful of women, and it was really fun. And you know, I thought I was gonna end up last, and I ended up not being last, so that encouraged me to keep going. And oh, this is so fun. And it was like a little community, and so you'd go to the next contest and see, you know, run into people that you knew, and one thing led to the next. And my brother and I went to Whistler for the Camp of Champions, except we didn't want to pay to go in the camp, so we just kind of poached the half pipe, and we stayed for a few days, and then we left and we went to Mount Hood, and I rode one day, and I could not stop riding the half pipe. It was so much fun. Our mountain didn't have any terrain, you know, so I just wanted to take advantage of riding the half pipe, and I just kept taking laps and hiking, and my brother and my friend were like, are you ready to go now? And I was like, no, this is so fun. I can't stop until it's like we're done. Like, they take us down. And and kick us out. And I met Brad Stewart, who was, you know, the person who, he gave me his card. And Brad Stewart started, he was with Sims, and then he started Morrow Snowboards and then on to Bonfire later on. But that was just an integral part of my career. And the next year, I started doing contests around the U.S. And, you know, you'd see, like, Craig Kelly shoveling, like, the hits and the half pipe, and everyone, they rode everything. So there were, like, there was a GS course, and then there's a pipe, and so you just rode everything. And there's footage of me, like, on my softboard, like, freestyle board down the race course, and that was, like, unheard of. Like, you had to be in your speed suit and your hard boots, and, like, oh my gosh, she's, like, in the finals on her soft boot setup, and it was funny. that was so funny. And then, you know, just things evolved, were evolving so fast, like new tricks being invented, and, you know, Terry just kind of going off, and all the riders just pushing themselves. And, you know, it was fun. Like, I met in 1990, I met Tina at, it was a PSTA event. And she just was so nice. And she came up to me like, hey, how's it going? And I was just so stoked to meet, you know, just kind of be invited into the culture. And because I didn't know anyone, I was new. And she just really kind of took me under her wing. She's like, oh, this is, there's this event, and this is what you do. And she was just, I don't know if people know this, but she really knew the importance of marketing women. And she, so her and I would team up and just be like, oh, well, let's do this to promote women snowboarding. And then Lisa and Gaylene, I mean, all these women are like the backbone of women snowboarding, just pushing it through and making it, is really what it is today, I think. But as far as contests go, how the pipe is, what the women are doing now is just, it is insane.
Did you get a chance to watch the Olympics?
Oh, totally. And I'm like, I'm glad I got out when I did, because I can't snowboard like that. And it's totally different. Yeah. It's a different sport, really.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the progression's pretty insane. But I will say the one thing that I think, for those of you guys that did watch the Olympics, is the camaraderie that you're talking about, yeah, that you guys had. Still comes across, all those girls, slopestyle, pipe, it's just, it makes it more fun to watch, because they're not, like, icing each other, you know, they're, yeah, hugging each other and high-fiving at the end of the run.
Well, I mean, if we didn't stick together, like, Barrett and Tina, you know, CB, and if we didn't stick together and just, like, kind of push our sport for ourselves, really, we weren't going to have anything, so yeah. It was, we had to do something to make it exciting and for the media to kind of accept us so that we could have a job and do what we love, pretty much.
Yeah.